This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. On today's show, I'll speak to Haiti Action Representative Seth Donnelly on a response to the joint statement from 9 House of Representative members on Haiti, and a tribute to Black Agenda Report's Bruce Dixon, who passed away on Friday of last week. Stay tuned. With all of the changes and fluctuations in government in Haiti, there are some latest developments, that being a statement, a response to the joint statement from the House of Representatives by the Haiti Action Committee based here in the Bay Area. And on the line to speak with us about this response to this joint statement by the House of Representatives, 9 members of the House of Representatives, is Seth Donnelly. And Mr. Donnelly has been with Haiti Action Committee since 2004. He's also a school teacher, so his plate is constantly full. He's also been to Haiti over 20 times. Mr. Donnelly, thank you so much for talking to us. Appreciate you being on the show.
Well, appreciate your show and what you're doing, Sabrina.
Right on. Well, let's get this conversation started. What is the latest that's happening right now in Haiti today?
So Haiti is in a revolutionary situation in the sense that the current regime of Jovenel Moïse has lost, well, it never had any credibility to begin with, but there's huge, ever-growing protests that continue to occur across the entire island, demanding his resignation and an end to that regime. In these huge protests, we're seeing, like, for example, on June 24th in Port-au-Prince, special police units and their paramilitary affiliates opening fire on unarmed demonstrators. There are news accounts from Haiti that on June 24th, perhaps as many as 30 people were killed by the police. We're seeing ongoing massacres occurring across the island to try to stop the protests and to stop the opposition. But the people of Haiti have had it, and they're not backing down.
Yeah, and that's a wonderful thing. I mean, that is the legacy of Haiti. That is the legacy of the people. They do not back down ever. ever, especially in light of what's happening, the grand scale grifting of the Petrocaribe money, and just I don't understand how they are getting away with it. President Moïse and Jovenel and all those people. I mean,
what's happened is Jovenel Moïse came to power back through fraudulent elections, and in 2016, and those elections were sponsored by the United States. There's overwhelming evidence of fraud and voter suppression. And so from the very beginning, he had no legitimacy. There were like 50 days straight of protests against those elections after they were declared over. Those protests were also about tear gas and repression, but people just continued to resist. And then last summer, around this time, actually, the Petrocaribe scandal had already been brewing, where the government had stolen billions of dollars worth of money that through oil loans from Venezuela. But then last summer, the government started to increase prices on basic gas and kerosene. And so there was an eruption of even more protests, huge protests across the entire island. And then intermittently ever since last summer, there's been huge protests across Haiti, in part over the Petrocaribe scandal and the fact that nobody's been held held accountable for that, even though the Haitian parliament has a report that identifies officials in the Moïse regime as being responsible, connected to this scandal. Nobody's been held accountable. Moïse himself was implicated in it. Of course, he has not been held accountable. And then on top of that, there was a horrific massacre in La Saline in November, and there's been a series of massacres since that. So the population has just hit a complete breaking point. We'll have to see what will happen this summer. We do know that if the United States would stop supporting economically and diplomatically the Milice regime, it would fall imminently.
Mm-hmm. Now, the joint statement by the nine House of Representatives members states, quote, while the frustrations that have prompted the protests are justifiable, the violent acts being used to express them are indefensible. Now, I understand that there will be a statement coming out from Haiti Action. Where do these nine members of the House of Representatives get off trying to judge, you know, what's justifiable, what's defensible, in light of what this so-called governing body of Haiti has been doing to its people?
Yeah, this June 18th statement is atrocious. It is an absolutely horrible.
It's completely tone deaf. It's completely tone deaf to what the people are going through down there. Who are these people, these members in the House of Representatives, listening to as far as any type of accurate report back about what's going on in that country?
Another part of the statement says, in addition to trying to lecture protesters on not being quote-unquote violent, the statement also says, we must do all that we can to ensure that Haiti does not become a failed state as this crisis unfolds. First of all, Haiti is a failed state, and it's a failed state because of U.S. imperialism and how the U.S. destroyed the last democratic government in Haiti in 2004, the elected president, Jean-Bertrand Aristide, mm-hmm. and then proceeded to see thousands and thousands and thousands of Haitians murdered. And that's when I started doing human rights documentation, was that summer. None of these representatives said very little. Now, Barbara Lee did speak out against the coup, and to her credit. But for the most part, the representatives signed this joint resolution or this statement, had nothing to say about the repression that's been happening in Haiti over the last 15 years. There was a study done for the medical journal The Lancet back in 2006, an investigation that's quite credible, that found that in Port-au-Prince alone, that in the first year and a half after the coup against President Aristide, there were 8,000 murders in the Port-au-Prince area alone. And that's certainly consistent with what we were starting to find. We were finding bodies left in the street, people being murdered all across the island by police and paramilitary forces, and also by UN occupation troops. Mm-hmm. So the idea that now, in the year 2019, now that there's this puppet regime that was installed through U.S.-sponsored fraudulent elections that is in trouble because the protests have hit a boiling point, the idea that now Haiti's in danger of becoming a failed state is patently absurd, and it's an insult to the Haitian people. So that right there, the entire premise of the letter is off. Secondly, in terms of the idea of violence, to equate protesters with stones and rocks, and in some cases carrying out property damage, although it must be emphasized the majority of people on the streets are not carrying out property damage or throwing rocks whatsoever. There's unarmed people being gunned down. But to equate people with stones, to these paramilitary affiliates and to these death squads and to the regime's special presidential police units that are butchering people, like in La Saline, is also an insult to intelligence. And that's where the Haiti Action Committee draws a parallel to Trump's statement after the Charlottesville to say, well, there was good people on both sides, or to equate, somebody driving a car into a crowd with anti-fascist folks using pepper spray. It's insane. Mm-hmm. That's right. So there is no equivalency here. And the letter throws a bone saying, we understand the frustrations. This is nothing about the frustrations, that the people are up against a U.S.-backed regime that has been that these folks in Congress have consistently supported. None of them has called for cutting off money to the Haitian police or to cutting off diplomatic support for this government. None of these folks have spoken out and said that in support of the people's movement's demand for an interim government that's truly capable of organizing democratic elections. All they say is they're going to have some conference later this July that will involve people from the Haitian diaspora as well as elected officials from Haiti. Nobody from Fami Lavalas, from the from the that's the biggest political party in opposition in Haiti. None of these grassroots popular movement leaders are apparently coming to this conference. So the statement is not only tone deaf, it's politically way off base and insulting.
It is very, very, very insulting. I want to get back to the violence, especially with what happened in La Saline. You were there after and observed what happened, and I want to talk about that, but let's take a quick break. I am speaking with Mr. Seth Donnelly, school teacher and representative for Haiti Action Committee, about the latest that's happening in Haiti, and stay tuned.
Live alive on my knees. You think I am messing? I am messing. You got something coming. Something coming.
And we are back. We are back speaking with Seth Donnelly, representative for Haiti Action Committee. He's given us the latest that is happening in Haiti in regards to the violence after La Saline. Just moving the conversation along, there will be a joint response, or excuse me, a response to the joint statement from 9 members of the House of Representatives coming out soon. And you can go to Haiti Action Committee's website to get that information. And I want to make sure I get that website right, HaitiSolidarity.net, HaitiSolidarity.net. Is that right, Mr. Donnelly?
That's right. Absolutely.
All right. So you were in La Saline. Now, you also said earlier in our conversation that there were, 6 or 7 more massacres in addition to the one after La Saline?
Well, what we found is, so the La Saline, the as far as we know, the largest massacre was in La Saline in several days, over several days in mid-November. But since then, there's continued to be, we were told on the ground in Haiti by folks in La Saline and Haitian human rights workers and journalists that there were perhaps as many as 8 more attacks on La Saline. And then there's been other attacks on other popular neighborhoods as well. For example, on June 18th, there's a poor neighborhood, a village de Dieu, that we're getting reports that there was a horrific massacre there as well. On April 24th and 25th, there were paramilitary attacks and killings in popular neighborhoods, Kafufe and Tokyo. So there's a pattern. There's been attacks down in Lakai in the south. So there's a pattern of this expanding. And what the perpetrators of the attacks are paramilitary affiliates. We think that's a more accurate term than the mainstream media is referring to these as gang attacks. But and that fits a very easy racist narrative in the United States of just gang violence in Haiti. When in fact these are heavily armed, weaponized paramilitary forces recruited by the government, working with the regime, armed by the regime, and that are targeting neighborhoods that are what Haitians call popular neighborhoods, the grassroots neighborhoods where masses of poor people live, and where there's high levels of political mobilization against the government. So, for example, La Saline, a poor neighborhood in Port-au-Prince, has been strategic in protests starting and moving from La Saline into broader Port-au-Prince against the government in terms of Petrocaribe protests, in terms of protests around stolen elections. So this is a neighborhood that is a base of the Lavalas movement. Again, Lavalas is the largest It's the People's Movement, the movement of the poor majority, and the Famila Valas is the largest political party, most popular political party in the country. So this is a Lavalas neighborhood that's been subjected to these attacks. And so, yes, we were there in April. We went to La Saline. We interviewed people, survivors of the November massacre, and gathered other evidence.
Yes, and folks may remember my conversation with Judith Merkinson. She was also there, and it was just a very graphic account that she gave to us, and it's very intense, very, very, very intense. So that action, those actions are being repeated over and over and over again, and there's no protection for the people. The members of Lavalas, or alleged members of Lavalas, or just your average poor Haitian trying to get from one point to another, try to make it through the day. There's absolutely no protection. Is that what you're saying?
That's right. And if I think it would be helpful for your listeners, especially if they missed the earlier interview you did with Merck, the ruling party, the party of Jovenel Moïse, is PHTK in Haiti. And so in the case of the massacre in La Saline, what we gathered, residents told us that in October, this last October, the First Lady, Martine Moïse, had gone to the neighborhood and attempted to bribe community leaders in La Saline to essentially call off the protests against the government. That failed. And so on November 1st, there was the start of the massacre where a paramilitary force loyal to PHTK called Chabon, which means charcoal, who are from a neighboring area near La Saline, they came in and attempted to, they killed one of the community leaders, and then another one was shot, but was then subsequently imprisoned by the regime. And that then sort of set the stage. There were some other people killed in that initial November 1st incident. And then on November 13th, Chabon came back, this time backed by, with police armored carrier vehicle equipped by Boyd, that's a specialized police unit. They had a very famous police officer who's a former police officer named Jimmy Cherizier, who's known in Haiti as Barbecue. They had other police officials, and they were heavily, heavily armed, including, according to recent records, one of the assault rifles that they had was registered with the National Palace. Reportedly, according to residents in La Saline, and there's been human rights investigations done inside of Haiti, that the coordinator of this November 13th massacre was a PHTK official in charge of that entire region of Port-au-Prince in Haiti, named Pierre Duplan. And he's one of other officials implicated in this, but his name consistently came up. In any event, this paramilitary force with police equipment and vehicles then proceeded to ransack the neighborhood for the next several days, perhaps 3 to 4 days. People were literally hacked to death, burned alive in front of family members. Women were raped. Even a 10-month child was killed. We went to one part of the community where there was the bones of a woman that had been burned alive. The community members told she was a pregnant woman who had been burned alive, and they were keeping her bones there as a memorial, what they called a mausoleum. Body parts were literally fed to pigs. There's plenty of photographic evidence of this. It's well documented. We gathered more while we were there and talked to folks who had seen their loved ones killed in front of them. We saw one older woman whose entire body was broken out in a horrific rash because she'd seen her son butchered in front of her. So this is the type of thing that is happening in Haiti. More recently, we received photographic evidence in Village de Dieu of where the massacre was also reportedly carried out by Jimmy Chérizier's forces or his group, that a body had been burned and only the legs left as a signature, right, to terrorize the population.
Wow.
So I say these things not just to be graphic, but so that listeners understand that the level of terrorism and repression that's happening in Haiti, and just how, which again not only shows how off base the joint statement we were discussing earlier is, but it also just shows the immense bravery of the Haitian people that keep taking to the streets in even larger numbers.
That's right. That's right. And they have to. It's the only way. I mean, that's just one of the things that, you know, they have to keep doing, unfortunately. I mean, they are struggling for, to quote, Haiti Action Committee response to the joint statement by the nine members of the House of Representatives. The people of Haiti are struggling for freedom, justice, and equality, for dignity, sovereignty, and unity. They are working to build a country. And why still in the 21st century after, quote unquote, over 200 years of freedom, so-called freedom, are they still having to do this and make these demands? I want to say thank you so much, Mr. Seth Donnelly. Seth Donnelly is a representative of the Haiti Action Committee based here in the Bay Area. Truly appreciate you taking the time and look forward to speaking with you in the very, very near future. Want to stay abreast of what's happening over there. Thank you so much.
May I just add one final thing? Is that possible?
Absolutely. Go right ahead.
Yeah. Just because one final point is that the U.S. State Department admitted in a recent letter to our representative down here, Anna Eshoo, that the U.S. government had spent $259.9 million, basically $260 million since 2010, in training and equipping the Haitian police.
Mm.
Okay. This and then the police and the forces are also being trained by U.N. occupation forces in Haiti. So a more appropriate statement by concerned members in Congress would be to speak out against a regime that is clearly installed through fraud, that does not deserve to be representing the people of Haiti, and to call for truly fair and free elections, and to ask to use their clout in Congress and the Appropriations Committee to cut off funding for a lethal police force that's clearly linked to these massacres. And I'd like to add that next Monday on July 8th, the National Lawyers Guild and Haiti Action Committee are releasing a report titled The Lost Saline Massacre and the Human Rights Crisis in Haiti. So that will have more in-depth documentation of what we've discussed today, and encourage listeners to check it out by going to the Haiti Action website.
All right, HaitiSolidarity.net, HaitiSolidarity.net. You can see the response. I want to make sure I got that correct. The response to the joint statement from the nine congressmen and women from the House of Representatives. Mr. Donnelly, appreciate you so much. Thank you so much for imparting your knowledge on everyone. As gruesome as a report back as it is, it needs to be said. We appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you so much.
Switch gears really quickly here and speak to Dr. Anthony Montero. Dr. Montero is or was a colleague of Bruce Dixon, as some of us have just found out, Black Agenda reports Bruce Dixon just passed away last Friday. And Dr. Montero, you worked with Mr. Dixon for many years. Talk to us about him for just the last few minutes here of the show. Talk to us about Bruce Dixon.
Yeah, Bruce was an exemplary figure in terms of a radical who really emerged as a revolutionary thinker and journalist. He's best known for his work with Black Agenda Report. And you know, as you know, Black Agenda Report is that voice of the black left. And so it is a critical voice and a site of critical thinking. And Bruce was foundational to that. One thing that he was known for is that he was not prepared under any circumstances to compromise on principle. And therefore, he never, in my knowledge, capitulated to the black misleadership class and its machinations and, as you might say, perpetrations. And, you know, Bruce started his activist career in Chicago in the Black Panther Party. And he was in that chapter of the Black Panther Party that produced the likes of Fred Hampton. And he never backed up. He was never ceased to be who he was in those early days of hot struggle and confrontation with the most reactionary and fascist elements of the U.S. ruling class. He never backed away from that. But then on the other side, you know, he was this big, really sweet, very kind guy, man, very lovable cat, man, and always down to earth, always accessible, and always honest. So those are some of the things I remember about Bruce Dixon, and he will be sorely missed.
All right, all right. Dr. Anthony Montero, we appreciate that that dedication to Bruce Dixon. We're all feeling the loss. We're all feeling the loss on so many levels. Thank you so much. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. A big thank you to my guests, Seth Donnelly and Dr. Anthony Montero, for taking the time. The lovely Lucrecia Burton is on the controls. I'll be back next week, same time, same place. Hard Knock Radio's up next. Have a wonderful week of resistance, community, and thank you for listening.
Years after the Watts Rebellions that took place in August of 1965, a benefit concert was organized by Stax Records to commemorate it. The documentary Watts Stax was the result. Key appearances in the film include Richard Pryor, Jesse Jackson, Isaac Hayes, the Staple Singers, and many more, and includes community interviews along with the festival footage. So join KPFA on Tuesday, July 2nd for the documentary Watts Stax with a post-movie discussion led by me, Greg Bridges. For more information, check out kpfa.org or thenewparkway.com. This is a KPFA benefit.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.
And you are tuned into KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno,
Please stay tuned for Hard Knock Radio.